As of the release of this video, it's been 15 years since the movie was released in theaters. Imagine that. 15 years ago, every Star Wars fan thought this was going to be the last film of the saga, the one to complete Anakin's descent to the dark side and Luke's destiny to save him. The circle is now complete. At the time, this had to be something satisfying, tie up loose ends and end on a bang. It's considered the best of the prequels and currently to this day has positive ratings and is the best Star Wars film of all time, according to me.
I do remember going to the cinema to see this film when I was 5. I barely remembered anything from it until I rewatched it around 2014. I liked it. Sure, I didn't understand most of the plot relevance because I didn't watch any Star Wars film prior to Episode 3. I just jumped straight into it. But I enjoyed its awesome battle sequences, the art style, the beautiful music composed by John Williams, and those little moments that made me just go like, ah! And the story. If it wasn't for this film, I would never have gone back to see the Star Wars saga.
I was a teenager back then. I saw Star Wars as some high fantasy space opera, nothing more. Watching them at 20 is quite different. Everyone grows and learns more about the world, our experiences, events, and our beliefs define who we are. Works of art, whether we create them or enjoy them for what they are, can be interpreted and experienced in different ways because people come from all walks of life. Star Wars is no different. They are considered, even by George Lucas himself, children's films. They're fun, the characters are relatable, and the stories are exciting. Yet, they aren't just films for children to indulge in. They are films with messages in them. A New Hope came out not long after the polarizing and criminal Vietnam War. The American people hated it, and the Vietnamese suffered greatly by the war crimes committed in their country. The film was greatly influenced by that war for the imperialism and the lies and atrocities that went on over there. The Empire is a fascist one, committed to oppressing and gaining power, going as far as committing genocide to instill fear across the galaxy to ensure no one stands against them. The rebellion fought against this power to free the people from the Empire. The parallels between the Vietnam War and the rebellion's fight against the Empire are pretty strong on a surface level.
Of course, the Vietnam War is much more complicated to talk about, and even Star Wars can't make a strong parallel analysis within a 2-hour time frame. It has a high action story to tell.
Everyone, though, at least understands something like the Empire from Star Wars is not desirable. No one would really agree to live under a system like that. But regimes like the Empire have existed in real life. Places were transformed from a liberal democracy to a fascist dictatorship. The middle part from point A to point B, democracy to fascism, is crucial to understand how we avoid falling down a fascist road. A New Hope illustrates the end road and how we can overturn it through revolution. Revenge of the Sith shows the middle part to how society descends into totalitarianism and how we can lose our own humanity along with it.
So this is how liberty dies, with thunderous applause.
The Clone Wars, the war fought between the Galactic Republic and the Separatist Alliance, who are supported by corporations such as the Trade Federation and secretly by the Sith. It showed the principles the Republic stood for of democracy and freedom were either being rotted away or showed the true colors that they never existed to begin with. By the events of Revenge of the Sith, the Republic is already in a weakened state, consumed by perpetual warfare and the cost of the war, and susceptible to outright corruption unlike anything seen before in the Republic. Years before the war, the Republic turned a blind eye to corporate tyranny when the Trade Federation invaded Naboo under the pretense of a blockade. What makes this an interesting point is that it's a corporation invading a world as though they're a government with an army. The whole point of capitalism is to make a profit in a competitive market against your competitors. If the company failed, it should mean you failed because you couldn't compete due to your rivals being able to cater to consumers and offering better deals or commodities. But if you wipe out the competition, creating a monopoly in this vacuum, well, the consumers will have no other choice than to use your services, even if they're terrible. To keep your economy going, you need resources. It doesn't matter what it operates under, they need resources. The invasion of Naboo signifies the control corporations have over the entire system. They don't need the government to invade and steal resources. They can do that themselves with their own private army. Society in that world is controlled by corporations. It's a corporatocracy. The reason why I'm going over the plot point from The Phantom Menace is that it relates to how right-wing populists use anti-elite, anti-bureaucracy, and for-the-people rhetoric in order to attain power. Palpatine, who allied with the Federation to invade Naboo, needed to oust Chancellor Valorum from his position of Chancellor to assume his leadership. He convinced Queen Amidala that Valorum was a weak leader who caved to bureaucracy and corruption, allowing corporatocracy to exist in the Republic and was thus powerless to free her people from the invasion and to call for a vote of no confidence. While true, Valorum did cave to corruption, ousting him was done with insidious intention. Pun intended. Palpatine secured his leadership as Chancellor, likely due to his popularity as a politician that's sort of implied in the film, and gave him great influence and power in the Republic. But he couldn't convert democracy to a dictatorship with the power he had attained as Chancellor. The Republic had to be undermined, weakened to a state of uncertainty and fear of collapse. It had to be a waiting game to play his cards right. If fascism and other types of authoritarian ideologies are not recognized or stopped, they can spread like a virus. Very much how Palpatine had allies in positions of power alongside him, removed as much opposition to his leadership as he could to further undermine democracy and the Republic. To truly weaken the Republic, a devastating war had to have such a severe impact on the security and freedom of the people. The Clone Wars was just that.
Once more, the Sith will rule the galaxy. We shall have peace.
This looks hypocritical of Palpatine, which it is, of course, but this line reveals how the Sith view the world. George Orwell's 1984 has one of the most well-known phrases in literature. Yeah, everyone quotes it, but I've actually read the book, unlike some weird right-wing people who reference the book when they clearly haven't read it. War is peace, freedom is slavery. Ignorance is strength. It beautifully encapsulates how fascists think in the most ironic way ever. Peacetime, in their mind, creates weak men, thus creating hard times. Strong men create peaceful times. Perpetual warfare is needed to produce strong men. So peace doesn't exist. It's contradictory by design. When Palpatine says it, he's talking about unending wars. It's almost subtle in a way. People wrote it off as a contradictory line. It was done with that intent in mind. Palpatine was a menacing villain in Return of the Jedi, tormenting Luke at every corner to push him to the dark side. In this film, we see how evil he actually is. That smile he gives is almost as if he's mocking the very concept of peace, knowingly bastardizing the definition to mean the opposite. That all the lives that will be sacrificed in the new world is one he relishes in. He's a loveless, hateful, genocidal being, and this film does such a great job of giving its villain depth. During his speech in the Senate of how the Jedi plot to take over the Republic had been foiled, he, with the emergency powers he had and support from the Senators, converted the Republic to a totalitarian state, an empire. The Republic had been weakened to the point of panic and uncertainty by its own leader. The Senators were more than willing to rescind democracy for security and to avoid collapse. Before I forget, you might be wondering why I call Palpatine and the Sith fascists. Take a look at the stormtroopers. None of them are any species besides humans. They likely view humans as superior. All of the soldiers are men too. The structure of the Empire is a patriarchy. Even the Empire is based on the Nazis. Star Wars is literally a fight against space Nazis. The Jedi's involvement in the Clone Wars showed a turn in the Jedi Order. They perceived themselves to be the guardians of peace and justice, not warriors. They betrayed their own philosophy when they joined the fight in the Clone Wars, leading many of the battles as commanders. Besides that, they weren't perfect either prior to the war. Their doctrine was dogmatic, isolationist, and, in a way, dehumanized the Jedi followers. Their code forbids them to love. It's one of the most quintessential aspects of humans. It stops them from falling in love with the person they love and a connection to humanity. An interesting idea someone pointed out to me once got me thinking about the controversial inclusion of midichlorians. I think, bear with me as I defend the midichlorians, they give us an idea of how the Jedi treat their status as Force users. The midichlorians are a scientific explanation of how the Force communicates with all living beings, and how the Jedi use it as a basis of who should be taken into the Jedi Order. They're using biological determinism to pick who is and who isn't a Force user, when it might not actually be a power a few people are born with. Midichlorians have a symbiotic relationship with all living things. Wouldn't that mean everyone has the potential to become a Force user? Sure, others like the already established Jedi had it easier to communicate with the Force, but that shouldn't stop everyone with only training and knowledge to unlock their potential abilities. Since the Jedi excluded everyone and followed their religious doctrine, it was inevitable that the Jedi were going to become overconfident in their own abilities to assess danger, since they believed they were all-powerful and all-knowing. They know what's best. Yet, they downplay the possibility the Sith could return after 1,000 years of maintaining peace across the galaxy without them knowing of it first, even when Qui-Gon Jinn fought against a Sith Lord on Tatooine. They underestimated the cunning threat of the Sith and Darth Sidious. Palpatine evaded them for so long, he didn't need to personally kill them. He gained political power until he was capable of turning the Republic against their most valuable and trusted guardians. They had the power to see glimpses of the future, use the Force to guide them. The Sith, though, were under their noses the entire time. This new threat was something they were woefully unprepared for. When Obi-Wan revealed to Windu and Yoda, after the Battle of Geonosis, that someone in the Senate was a Sith Lord, they disregarded that idea and asserted that Dooku and his master wanted them to distrust their allies. They remained confident in their own wisdom and the Force when it was clearly failing them. When Anakin told Windu Palpatine was the Sith Lord they were looking for, it seemed unreal, an absolute shock to him. The film displays the wise, the people we look up to for guidance, can fail us due to maybe arrogance, egotism, following dogma that forbids them from doing something morally right. The Jedi believed they were on top of everything, but Palpatine was pulling the strings in the shadows the entire time, gaining power over the entire Senate. Before the Jedi knew, the Republic was on Palpatine's side and lost trust with the Jedi. They were powerless to stop him, so they resorted to illegally remove him from power by violence. When Mace Windu defeated Sidious, he resorted to execute him on the spot without trial. In the film, they state it's not the Jedi way to kill your unarmed opponent, either it's seen as honorless or morally wrong to do. Windu understood what was at stake though. Sidious was not going to be prosecuted. The judges were already on his side. The whole system was on his side. The Jedi changed. They viewed themselves above the Sith. The Sith were honorless, impatient, authoritarians. They feared if they resorted to how the Sith act, killing unarmed opponents for example, then they wouldn't be that much different from them. Which means that probably their philosophy, though not entirely, isn't all that good if they had to resort to the same methods of the Sith to stop the Sith. Episode 3 displays the failure of the Jedi not because they were defeated by the Sith, but because their values, their philosophy, worked against them. These old ideas could not account for the likes of Darth Sidious and how far he was going to cheat, rig the system and turn their allies away from them. They also didn't account for Anakin Skywalker and how their philosophy pushed him away. Revenge of the Sith is a film about failure. People failed each other, failed to listen, and stayed committed to ideals that weren't suited to handle the problems facing the Republic and the Jedi Order. In the original trilogy, architecture in many places and vehicles on Tatooine, Yavin 4, Cloud City, and Hoth, including the design and interior of the Death Star, have this rustic, crude, almost cheap design to them. Everyone, more so of those living in the poorer regions of the galaxy, lives under an oppressive regime, and all of the resources and wealth are diverted to strengthen the Empire. The Emperor and his allies become wealthier, and the poor become poorer. So the massive economic disparities played an influence on the revolution and the re-emergence of the Jedi in the form of Luke Skywalker. Remember how Luke wanted to go to an academy in A New Hope but couldn't because Owen couldn't afford to do the harvest by himself? Things were already rough under the Republic. Slavery was still permitted in the poorer regions, with the Empire's desire to continually oppress and keep the people fearful of standing up to them. People start to struggle to be ensured they are guaranteed a good life. They become slaves to the system, just without the chains. During the days before the Empire, Coruscant, in the wealthier parts, had a pristine look to it. The opera house shone an array of neon colors in the night sky. Vehicles had various designs. It wasn't a utopia by any means, but we can see the stark differences between the Republic and life under the Empire. The lightsaber fights also reflect the differences from the Jedi in their prime to Luke's more improvised fighting style. Anakin's and Obi-Wan's duel on Mustafar is one of my favorite fights in cinema. The duel really isn't a fight that decides the fate of the galaxy. The Empire had already won with the Jedi Purge of Order 66 and established a totalitarian regime, so the outcome of this fight remains the same either way whoever wins. The Empire remains in power. So the duel is more of a personal battle, like the one in Return of the Jedi where Luke's mission to save his father didn't impact the Rebellion's destruction of the Death Star. Luke's fight with Vader and Kenobi's fight with Anakin are focused on a more emotional angle. The Mustafar duel is two brother-like friends fighting in a place crumbling to pieces until at last Kenobi disarms Anakin. The scene gets memed to death, but it is emotionally powerful. Obi-Wan cries out his heart at someone he loved and turns away to let him die, unable to bring his suffering to an end. Revenge of the Sith is definitely the darkest episode. How the tone shifts is one I find quite clever. The opening is an energetic, captivating space battle. The sound of Obi-Wan and Anakin's spacecraft whizzing past the camera and over a star cruiser, emerging to a raging battle below. The Jedi chopping the droids to pieces. One weird bit. It's a fun sequence to capture the audience's attention. It feels like you're watching a high action adventure story. That tone shifts by one simple action that starts a domino effect, and the film progressively gets darker from this point onward. Anakin disarmed Dooku and is told to kill him by Palpatine. He's unsure, but caves into his impulses and decapitates Dooku. We can see from his reaction how pointless it was, how unnerved he feels by his own actions. Immediately, he recognizes he shouldn't have done it. It was cruel and honorless. Palpatine plants the seeds of justification to settle in him by the fact Dooku deserved it, pushing him closer to the dark side. There's this little bit that happens when Anakin and Padme are talking about the baby they're going to have. The uncertainty of how long they can keep this a secret is nerve-wracking for them, but they reassure each other everything will be fine. It gives the tone a sense they will have a happy ending. Immediately, the scene transitions to ominous music of General Grievous traveling to a planet to speak to Darth Sidious, casting aside the facade of a happy ending to reveal a tragedy will soon unfold.
Soon I will have a new apprentice, one far younger and more powerful.
This edit here juxtaposes hope and dread side by side effectively and really sets the stage for the tragic storyline. It happens once again after Grievous' scene back to Anakin and Padme through a beautiful aerial shot of Coruscant at night and sweet sounding music to accompany their romance. Admittedly, the dialogue is a bit weak.
No, no, it's because I'm so in love with you.
But it serves well enough to establish a happy scene of them. It's the only scene where they're happy together. Juxtaposed is Padme dying in childbirth in Anakin's dream. What follows is a scene I don't think gets enough credit. Anakin's unwilling to tell Padme what frightened him. He tries to get his mind off his nightmare to shift the conversation to the necklace he gave to her when he was a child. But he fears exactly the same thing will happen as his dreams of his mother's death came true. I feel like it's a nice back and forth between these two, and the dialogue feels natural considering the love story in Attack of the Clones didn't feel convincing. They feel like people expressing worry about their future and child. Padme even asks what happened to a child in his nightmare, expressing what a pregnant mother would feel. Following the next day, Anakin goes to seek Yoda for guidance. He says he's worried about losing someone without revealing who, but Yoda doesn't help him.
Death is a natural part of life. Rejoice for those around you who transform into the Force. Mourn them do not. Miss them do not. Train yourself to let go of everything you fear to lose.
The Jedi philosophy of the fear of losing someone is a gateway to the dark side and inadvertently backfires on the Jedi, as demonstrated later in the film. This philosophy makes the Jedi emotionless robots, carrying out orders from the Council but meant to differentiate good and evil and not to act on emotion. People's morals on what is good or evil is based on emotion. Humans are capable of empathy and we connect with people who are suffering. Sometimes people are willing to sacrifice to save people they love. Anakin wasn't like the rest of the Jedi. He still loved Padme years before they were reunited. His worries were cast aside like they were nothing. He felt the Jedi didn't care and felt they abandoned him at his most desperate hour. The only person he felt was honest and most caring was Palpatine. He listened and acted as a father to him, considering Anakin never had a father at all. This, of course, was a ploy, an act, to radicalize into the dark side and emotionally tear at him, that the Jedi were in fact evil, since they weren't really much different from the Sith.
So Revenge of the Sith is about how a teenager listened to too much of Jordan Peterson and fell down the alt-right rabbit hole and became a full-on Nazi.
Layer after layer is built in Anakin's character where it feels understandable from where he's coming from, while not justifying it since he literally kills children for the Empire. The Jedi's growing inability to help and distrust of Anakin's growing power plays into his character and what he wants out of life. Watching these films, I get a sense he became disillusioned in the Jedi Order. He was told constantly he is destined for a great purpose. Yet, we see he's actually lonely, nervous, doesn't fit in, and is distrusted for his own potential. Once he was reunited with Padme, he goes against the ideals of the Jedi and marries her. What makes this film a particularly strong tragedy is that Anakin probably would have left the Jedi soon after the Clone Wars ended. They both talk about raising their child on Naboo and act as though they can freely be open about their relationship instead of trying to hide it. That's what Anakin wanted in his life, to be with the person he loved the most to his dying days. He wanted to fulfill his life. All of it was snuffed away. Anakin's fear of Padme's death came true only through his own actions. The brutality of Anakin's betrayal doesn't come from relishing the suffering he's inflicting. He recognizes what he's doing is wrong, and it makes his turn to the dark side that the more heart-wrenching. On Mustafar, he stares down at the river of lava after he finished killing the Separatist leaders. It symbolically shows the opposite meaning of Luke's binary sunset, that there's a whole world out there that he could be a part of, to Anakin's dark eclipse shrouding him in all of the dark deeds he had committed. The inner conflict is overwhelming, but he knows it's impossible to turn back. He's doing this all to save Padme, as in his words,
"Just help me save Padme's life. I can't live without her."
This film gives the saga a different outlook. The originals were a tragedy themselves, but remain steadfast that we can overcome authority by solidarity and compassion. But the lead up to the Empire's Reign of Terror shows what was lost, the pain, the suffering, on a more direct level by knowing who these characters were personally, giving the original trilogy more strength for what they are fighting for. The Jedi detach themselves from personal possessions and people they would emotionally bond with in fear of being tempted by evil. They became apathetic to people's own personal problems. Anakin fell to the dark side from premonitions of Padme's death and Palpatine's manipulations. Luke Skywalker went to Cloud City against the warnings from Ben Kenobi and Yoda to save his friends at the risk of his own life. The story of Star Wars, where people put their own life on the line, not out of necessity, but out of compassion, is a story of love. Sounds cliched, but bear with me. Luke risked his life to save Leia from the Empire. He wasn't ordered to, he didn't know her. He did it because it was the right thing to do. Compassion drove him to save her. In turn, when Vader was about to kill Luke in the canyon of the Death Star, Han Solo returned and saved him out of compassion, the love for his friend he had bonded with throughout the film. The power of love might be stronger than the power of the Force. Padme, on her dying words, believed there was still good in Anakin, echoing the same words Luke spoke to Vader. Anakin turned to the dark side for his love for Padme, but it was the love of his son that saved him. This film resonated with me strongly. It inspired me to learn more about filmmaking and how art in general is constructed. I typically don't like having to rely on outside source material to understand every intricate detail or plot point of a story. So if you felt that I was interpreting much from the story instead of relying on what the source material has to say in books, TV shows, video games, YouTube videos, you guessed right. I don't like this approach to storytelling where you have to read outside source material to get a complete picture. I believe the story on its own should suffice in given explanations and the ideas embedded in the framework of the narrative. My interpretation can stray away from what the storyteller had in mind. This isn't to say the storyteller's beliefs don't matter and that those beliefs don't impact the story in any way. The story can be an extension of the author's ideas and what they are trying to say to the world, or they could have a goal in mind to impact the audience in a certain way. People who tell horror stories are trying to either scare or disturb the viewer, for instance. George Lucas once spoke about Return of the Jedi and what he wanted out of Star Wars. The whole point of the film, the whole emotion I am trying to get at the end of this film, is for you to be real uplifted, emotionally and spiritually, and feel absolutely good about life. That is the greatest thing that we can possibly ever do. I honestly admire this sentiment. There are directors who don't care about the film they're working on and are only in it for the money. George cared about his films and what they had to say. The original trilogy's anti-authoritarianism is prevalent. It parallels to the Vietnam War and World War II, and many other ideas like its religious undertones are commonly discussed. Yet the idea of love being stronger than the Force isn't widely discussed nor explicitly implied in the films. But I feel this theme describes who we are as humans. We share commonality, we empathize, than it being some trivia or some lore for Star Wars. People have always come together during moments of terror and uncertainty. People were frightened of what might happen if the Allies lost World War II. Yet, people still stuck together, people helped each other, and sometimes risked their lives to save others. Compassion and love drives humanity forward. The Empire sought to divide the galaxy and keep them oppressed, but it was division that brought people together to overthrow their oppressors.
After the fighting is over, how will people move on and rebuild? Will the new Jedi share their knowledge of the Force and wisdom to outsiders and abandon their biological determinist attitudes? Will society decentralize the government? Whatever new world there is after the Empire and Jedi, that is up to the new generation to decide.
Oops.
That is why I think Revenge of the Sith is genius. But really? Why Star Wars is amazing? I mean, I didn't want to just go over one film. I needed to reel you in and just go over the great things I love about Star Wars. Oh, the video is ending now.